Hi, I'm Tim Berglund with Confluent, here in Mumbai, India, to tell you all about Apache Kafka 4.0. If you wanted a top-level summary of what 4.0 is all about, it really is the continuing journey of Apache Kafka to become more cloud native. That really sums up a lot of the things that are going on. Not everything, but that's the general theme. So let's dive into the kips. Finally, the long journey from KIP 500 is done, and ZooKeeper has been removed fully, deprecated with extreme prejudice, as you might say. Earlier, KRaft had been enabled and approved for production use. ZooKeeper was still an option. Now it's not. So this gives us a more scalable Kafka, a more resilient Kafka. There's a component that you just don't have to worry about. Kafka with better metadata management performance. And again, one that is friendlier to run in the cloud. There were some cloud deployment scenarios that were really just all but impossible with ZooKeeper. And having that extra component around, having to deal with the networking, was just not a thing for modern deployment architectures. So we're glad to thank ZooKeeper for its years of service and send it to its retirement. KRaft is now the way to go. KIP 848 is the new consumer rebalance protocol. Now, a consumer group and the cluster, they have this very organic relationship. And when the consumer group changes size by adding a node or losing a node, there has to be a rebalance. Partitions have to be reassigned to the instances in the consumer group. Historically, that is very, very cooperative, meaning there was a lot of code in the client. The clients were pretty heavyweight, and the brokers were kept lightweight. Now, this has always been a thing in Kafka. We've always tried to keep the brokers dumb, as I say, keep functionality out of the brokers. There's been a tremendous amount of discipline architecturally around that, and it's been a good thing. However, with the increasing prevalence of cloud deployments and people trying to build cloud-native Kafkas for efficient use in the cloud, it was a good idea to start pulling some of that back into the broker, because you kind of can't control what's going on with all those clients. You can, to a greater extent, control what's going on the broker side. So more of that functionality has been pulled into the broker. As you can see here on the slide, there's really a lot to say about this. And I'll say this again, check the release notes. There's a lot of detail here into this kip. But I just want you to have that basic idea that that functionality has come out of the client, has been pushed into the broker in this new rebalance protocol. So we should see your typical modern Kafka deployment working better when you've got consumer groups and rebalances that have to happen. This is enabled by default in 4.0, and of course, wouldn't be complete if we didn't have enhanced metrics as well, so you're able to observe what's going on when the rebalance is happening. KIP 932. Now, let me tell you what 932 is not. 932 is not complete queue functionality in Apache Kafka. It's a thing that's been talked about for years, and it is a thing that is now officially in progress, but this isn't the whole thing. This is an experimental feature to start the process. 932 introduces a feature called share groups. I can define a group of consumers as a share group, and that group of consumers in the share group will be able to, for example, all consume from the same partition. Now, historically, a single consumer instance could only consume from one partition and no other instances could touch it. So that way we had guaranteed ordering. Of course, with queues, we're willing to give that up so that we can radically scale out the number of consumers we have reading from one topic. And this is the beginning of that. It's share groups as an experimental feature. Very important for me to emphasize, this is not for production use. In fact, if you enable it, which you'll have to do, with an undocumented config, check the release notes for the config, on that cluster where you've enabled share groups, you will not be able to upgrade that cluster to the next release, okay? So when I say not for production use and really for testing only, I mean it. But it's the beginning of an exciting journey. Somewhere in the 4.x cycle, we're expected to have full queue functionality. There will be other kips you'll see along that way. And if that's something you're interested in, get started playing around in a non-production cluster with this kip. KIP 1106 adds duration-based reset. Now, typically in auto offset reset, you've got earliest and latest, right? Now, with KIP 405 and tiered storage, earliest might be really freaking early, right? That may be a very long time ago, a lot of data to read through. So now we have this by duration option where we can go back a certain amount of time. That just makes resetting for very large tiered storage topics not quite so bad. KIP 1102 improves on 899. Now, 899 has to do with rebootstrapping. Bootstrapping is when a client comes up, talks to a broker, and gets the metadata it needs about all the nodes in the cluster. That is constantly refreshed every so often when the client is talking to the cluster. But imagine this, kind of a Rip Van Winkle scenario. The client goes down for a long time. Then the whole cluster changes. All of the nodes change. All the brokers are different names, different addresses now. Application comes back up and sees, this is all stale metadata and it doesn't work anymore. So 1102 gives you proactive rebootstrapping every so often, a configurable interval, or server-triggered rebootstrapping. Just so in this case where you have an application that's gone for a long time and comes back up, you're protected against that stale metadata. KIP 966 protects against a narrow little circumstance in which data could be lost. If you had a single NSYNC replica that was the leader and it had written data to disk, the operating system says, of course, we've taken that write, everything is fine, but it's in the page cache before it's actually written to storage. And then the broker goes down, it was only on that replica, you've got a situation where data could be lost. So 966 gives us a new set of replicas called the eligible leader replicas that are guaranteed to have data up to the watermark, protecting against this narrow little circumstance where data could have been lost. So let's move on to Kafka Streams and KIP 1076 and 1091. These have to do with observability in Kafka Streams. Before, you had to be very specific as a developer of a Streams application and manually expose all the metrics that you wanted reported. It was difficult, it took manual work. 1076 extends KIP 714, which allows the cluster to pull observability data from the client itself. So now cluster operators can get access to the state of the application. That way, if say there's a managed Kafka provider, they can build observability stuff into their application that can report in detail on the state of your Kafka Streams app. 1091 extends that in specific ways with metadata about stream threads inside the Kafka Streams application. KIP 1112.1112 gives us the processor wrapper interface. Now, you might have some kind of cross-cutting concern in a Kafka Streams application. You know, logging is a typical example. If you're using the processor API, okay, you can do that manually if you want. If you're using the DSL, you're a little bit stuck with logging anything going on inside of DSL calls. You just don't have access. So processor wrapper is a way for you to provide custom code that gets run automatically inside there, inside the DSL methods, for you to be able to do whatever that cross-cutting concern is. I'm talking about logging, but there are others, whatever it is you need, you have the opportunity to do that. So processor wrapper should make it a little bit easier for you to instrument your Streams applications. KIP 1104 lets you extract a foreign key from the key of a message. I don't know, it might seem obvious to you, but it used to be impossible. You used to be able to go into a field in the value and turn that into a foreign key when you're rekeying a stream, but now you can grab a foreign key from key itself. So that simplifies the join process with this more intuitive API. It kind of works the way you'd expect it to. KIP 1065 gives us better automated retry mechanisms. Now, imagine you've got a situation where you're consuming from some input topic, but your output topic is unavailable. You're gonna get an error for every single message. That is not fun at all. Tedious, lots of log data to sort through. This just gives us a way to be a little bit smarter about that and periodically log the outage, log the first error, you know, whatever that is. We've got more options now to give us a friendlier log in the case of those error conditions. And that sums it up for 4.0. The things you want to take home are Zookeeper is gone, KRaft is how we manage metadata now, it's official, and we're moving forward. Queues are not present in 4.0, but they're getting started. It's been talked about a lot, it's been awaited a lot, and we got the beginning, the first KIP in that direction. There'll be more. So stay tuned in, read the release notes, as always, you need all those details. And as always, I'd love to hear what you build.